sitting over there in the room. So I'm going to tell you more about this attack on this authenticated encryption scheme called Offset 2 Realms, and how we found it and how it can be fixed. Right. So what is OTR? OTR is a CSR submission by Katsuhiko Minamatsu that was presented at EuroCrypt in 2014. It's a red one. Authenticated encryption means that for a single block of plain text, you only need a single block cipher call. It's based on trivial block ciphers. And this can be seen as an inverse-free version of CP, low-gateway OCP, because it only needs the forward way of the block cipher, not the inverse. It can be based only on the PRF security of block cipher. And to do this, Mimatsu used this nice two rounds of facetail construction. And in the paper, this construction is constructed or is defined for any size, any block size. And you'll see this is kind of important. So really quickly, what is a trickle block cipher? Well, you just had a public input or certain input to the block cipher called Twig. And this input will add variability. More formally, for each tweak, we'll define a new independent pseudorandom or random permutation. So you have this formal definition here. I will not go over it. It's like something really classic now. Just to remember, this two-block cipher thing has been introduced by Scott Frivis and Wagner in 2002. So this has been going on for quite a while. And it's really useful to define authenticated encryption schemes. So really quickly, so this is how you encrypt the first, like the main message. You separate blocks by pairs of two, and then each pair of blocks goes through this two rounds of facetail construction. Each round is defined with a different tweak, so you have different permutations here. Well, it's quite like the privacy the goes quite strictly because of this. And for the last blocks, well, it depends whether you have a number of blocks that are even or odd. And depending on the case, you use, again, this facetail construction, like a big tweak or something that looks like. And then to compute the tag, you have this checksum here that is taken over essentially the even blocks. And you encrypt it using a new tweak. So in the original paper, Matsu shown that if tile E is tweakable per P, then OTR is essentially secure and also unforgeable. And this is not something we're going to study here because we're not attacking this part. What we are interested in is the way the tweakable block cipher is shaped. So really quickly before going on, I want you to remind that we're, as usual, working on a binary field represented as a polynomial field over F2 quotiented by a polynomial P. P is often like, is a primitive polynomial of the region. So in Matsu and as like in other constructions, we can consider the XOR encrypt construction that was introduced in a paper by originally in OCB. So the idea is to encrypt the message with a mask, then this mask has to be like computed, often using the nonce and other elements of the tweak. So in Rogoway, in the 2004 paper of Rogoway, this tweak is looking like this one, like this. Where delta is the encryption of the nonce, so essentially you shift delta by I, and then you like shift and re-XOR delta by j. And the reason why you consider something like this is that it's really easy to incrementally compute the delta ij's. Like it's really trivial to compute delta I plus 1 j from delta I j by just shifting the old value of the map. And the same thing for when you're modifying j. In Minimax 2, or in the version 1 and 2 of OTR, also for efficiency reasons, this masking scheme has been modified. Now you have something that looks like this for masks that are used in the encryption part, so in the Festool construction. So you shift, and maybe you add the b is equal to 0 or 1, and so you first shift delta, and then you might have to add delta. And this more complicated mask here is used for the tag part of the scheme. And here you can see that, again, you can incrementally compute the deltas one from each other, like really incrementally get them. And that's what make OTR efficient. So, and what's the flow in the implementation of the TwiddleBook cipher? Well, so there is this comma in the paper. So you can see these are elements that are generated from this first type of mask here. And here are the elements generated using the second, like the mask for the composition part. Right. The problem is that this is not true in general. So why is this not true in general? Well, again, we should take a look back at what's done in our OCB. In the OCB paper, Rogoway bounds I and j so that this quantity I plus alpha j are all different, where alpha is the log of x plus 1 in basis x. And well, if you know that these elements are all different, then you'll know that these polymorphs here will be all pairwise constant. And this is exactly where the flow in the Minimatsu paper comes in. The point is that polynomials in this set are not necessarily distinct. And that's even worse. For some values q, even for like really small values q, this is not true. This is not true. I mean, yeah. And for example, if you consider p, which is a trinomial, so with only three coefficients, then you will really easily find a collision between x to the n and x to j plus 1. When your binary field is defined like this. So you have a trivial collision from some values of p. And the point is that this happens quite often. For more than half of the n's less than 10,000, there is an irreducible polynomial p that will define such a field. And for efficiency reasons, this is the polynomial you're going to choose to define your field. So in many cases, this collision will happen. But you might ask, well, okay, what about like standard block sizes, n equals 64, n equals 128? The point is that when 8 divides n, then you will not be able to find a trinomial defining the field. You have, at best, a pentanomial, so something with 5 non-zero. So in general, you don't have an immediate collision. The other point is that for software and hardware efficiency, we usually choose p such that the non-zero coefficients are regrouped on the least significant bytes. So you can take those two examples here for n equals 64 and n equals 128. So these are the usual polynomials we use to define all like the modes and the algebra on these fields. And you'll see that all the coefficients are regrouped towards the end of like are of low degrees. And this is interesting because for n equals 64, you see that you will have a collision among some polynomials we define. So this is some tweak polynomial that's going to be used for the encryption part, and this is going to be used for the authentication part. Again, you have a collision here because of the definition of the polynomial, and you have a collision in the tree polynomials. Okay. So this shows you that essentially the proof of OTR is flawed, even for practical parameters. But this does not really imply that there is a concrete like break or a confidentiality break or inferentiality break. So let's study like the kind of collisions we might encounter. So again, this is the set of the polynomials or the polynomials used for tweaks. We're going to have three types of collisions, either like inner collision in this subset, or in this subset, or in collision from this subset to this subset here. And we're not really considering like the end, like this remaining term, because this only happens because you have like incomplete blocks and so on. So it's not really important here. Okay. So you have these three types of collisions, and we showed in the paper that you will either break confidentiality, unforgeability, or both, depending on the type of collisions you have. I will not go over this in the presentation. You should not quickly look at the full paper. But essentially, the idea is to combine blocks according to those collisions, so that you know what's going to get into the block ciphers, and because you already know what's going to be into the block cipher, you'll be able to get collisions from the block ciphers, and you will be able to replay either the tag or find repetitions in your ciphertext and break the CPA secure game. Something really important is that this attack can be mounted with only a single query to an encryption oracle, and with a single message of a size max of ij blocks, so the biggest degree of this polynomial here. And for n equals 64, you will be able to break unfungibility using a single 1 kilobyte message. So this completely breaks the whole encryption scheme. So we studied the n equals 64. What about n equals 128? So again, usually for one equal to 128, we choose this polynomial. And again, there is no trivial collision as I showed you for n equals 64. Something important to realize is that this is not true for any polynomial p of degree 128. I mean, you could choose this polynomial here, which is irreducible, and you will again have a collision of the same type that the one we had from n equals 64. So more generically, can we find a collision among the tweak polynomials? Something really important to realize is that we're only interested in collisions with I and j that are less than 2 to 64, because the proof of the scheme only holds up to the birthday bound. So you're not really interested in what happens after this 2 to 64 blocks. And this is important because we cannot really have some algebraic way to find collisions by finding them in F2 to 64 and then lifting them to the 128, because those collisions will have all degree at least 2 to 64. So our only hope is to have or to do some kind of exhaustive search. This is quite easy to do because we just have to generate all the polynomials, sort them, and try to match them. And this is embarrassingly unparallelizable, so if you have a GPU or a big machine, this is something you can do extremely easily. Yet, you'll need a lot of memory and also a lot of time. So you kind of have to make some choices in the way you're implementing things. And we actually made some time memory trade-off to do this. And we look for any collisions where I and J are less than 2 to the 45. And we didn't find any. So essentially, what we have in the end is that because there is no collision among these polynomials here, OTR is secure when OTR, as defined in the original paper, is secure for n equal 128 as long as your messages are less than 2 to the 45 blocks. So that's long messages. It took us quite a lot of time to get this and also quite a lot of run. So the question is, what's going to happen after these 2 to the 45 blocks. Can we make any conjecture about what's going to happen? So something interesting is that if tweak polynomials behave like random ones, essentially we should have a collision just before the birthday bound. But we saw that for some primitive polynomials like that were used in the definition of the binary field, like collisions happen right away. So it's quite, supposing that these polynomials behave randomly is maybe quite an assumption, so that might not be good. So something we did is that we looked at all irreducible polynomial over F2 for n equals 32 and 64, and looked for all the first collision that was happening. And these are the results. So here you have the logs of the degrees here, and you can see, so this is for n equals 32, so you can see that you have a few collisions happening at really low degrees, and then most of the collisions happen like around like 2 to 13, or between 2 to 13 and 2 to 17. And this is even worse for n equals 64. For n equals 64, we have like 6 polynomials which create collisions at really low degree, essentially like trivial collisions. And for all the other ones, I mean, there is absolutely no collisions between 2 to the 6 and 2 to the 26 for other polynomials. And most of the collisions happen just at the birthday bound. This is really strange because it means that we have two kind of behavior. Either we have collisions extremely soon, or we have a collision that happens like if everything was or behaving randomly. So that's kind of funny, I think. And so we made this conjecture that there shouldn't be any collisions before 2 to 60. So we hope that OTR is secure with messages less than 2 to 60 blocks. And to conclude, we showed that OTR is insecure for many block sizes as defined in the original paper, that it's secure for n equal 128 when the message length is limited to 2 to 45 blocks, that it's probably secure almost up to the birthday bound, and something really important is that the last version of OTR that was tweaked for the last round of the CSAR competition fixes the issues after our paper, and Masu now uses Max from the original OCB2 paper, sorry, and so there shouldn't be any more issues on that side of the construction. Well, that's it. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, and you can find our paper on imprints.